Episode 167 of Australia's number one marketing show. This episode is dedicated to lightening the load of tired and overwhelmed small business owners everywhere.
Welcome to the Small Business Big Marketing Show, where successful small business owners share their secrets to take your marketing to the next level. Now here's your host, Tim Reid.
G'day listeners, welcome back to another episode of Australia's number one marketing show. I couldn't keep that charade up for too long. That said, this is a show dedicated to the tired and overwhelmed business owner, but I digress. Welcome back to another episode of Australia's number one marketing show. I'm your host, Timbo Reid. You right there, you might be tired, you might be overwhelmed, but because you're listening to this show, you are a motivated small business owner somewhere in the world wanting to crank out great marketing. And for that, I commend you. Big virtual hug coming through the airwaves to you. Well done for tuning in. And we are brought to you by the very good folks at Net Registry who want to help us along in the journey, specifically online marketing journey for them, because that's what they do really well. So if you've got an SEO thing happening that you want to solve, or you need a website designed or developed, you need a bit of pay-per-click love, the guys at Net Registry get you sorted across all those lines. So head over to smallbusinessbigmarketing.com, click on the Net Registry banner. You will find three exclusive packages starting at around $99 where they can help you out, or go to netregistry.com.au and just give them a ring. Tell them Timbo sent you. Now, welcome everyone from the flying solo community as well. I do love all you solopreneurs having a crack as well. We've got a big show today. It is about overwhelm. It is about tiredness. It is that time of the year. If my calculations are correct, this show will go out on Christmas Eve. So I'm guessing there's not going to be a lot of people kind of listening at that time, but it's a good one to listen to over the break. I'll be in Italy. I will be in Italy. Florence, I think, as this show goes to air as well. So I did promise to record a reflective episode at some point while I'm in Italy, which can go up New Year's Eve. Again, I'm not thinking many people will be listening to it New Year's Eve, but another good one to listen to launch into the year ahead. But today, hey, listen, this is what we've got, motivated small business owner you. Got a listener question that I'm going to answer about how to get started in social media, how to build a customer list, and a question about not being able to afford to outsource. All right, so we're going to talk about that. I get on my soapbox about people not listening. Yeah, bit of a rant from Timbo. Get some advice from a listener on microphones and a cool video marketing app that they share with us. And then my guest today, outsourcing specialist Chris Ducker. I have a fireside chat with Chris about helping out the tired and overwhelmed business owner. Chris himself in 2009 couldn't hop out of bed to get to work. He was shagged, and he's going to explain how he overcame it and has now got a thriving business that he, L-O-V-E, loves. So I get this listener question from Jenny Miller of the designersagency.com.au. G'day, Jen. Thanks a lot for the question. She says, "Hi, Timbo. I have just discovered your show. Where have you been, Jen? What's this dated? 10th of October, 2013. This show's been around for 4.5 years, Jennifer. And have been listening to new and old episodes. Love the show. So much valuable info. You talk a lot about outsourcing tasks that we, the business owner, are not so skilled at. I do. I talk a lot about getting a virtual marketing team, surrounding yourself with one, in fact. And we touch on that in today's interview. I am just wondering if you have some tips for those of us that are just starting out and do not have the dough, she says money, to employ people yet, be it hiring or subcontracting. So, how do we make a good start at growing our social media profile, Facebook in particular, and customer lists without hiring copywriters, marketing experts, etc.? Any simple tips would be appreciated. I will be over the moon one day, the day I can hire someone else to do the things that I am not confident at. But until that day comes, it's all down to me." Oh, Jen, we talk so much about this in today's interview. If it is to be, it's up to me. Stare. That's me stamping my fist on the desk, says the small business owner. We're such control freaks. I get the cash flow's a problem. I get that. But I also wonder, can we afford not to outsource some tasks, some stuff? And again, in today's interview, we talk about the fact that it's not as expensive as we think. You know, one of the three limiting beliefs that holds back us small business owners from cranking out great marketing is we think it's going to be really expensive, and it's not, right? Listen up. So let's crank through some of these questions that Jen's got. Jen, let me give you three ways to grow your social media profile as you start out, okay? Number one, enter the conversation, okay? This is a mindset tip, right? Social media is people having conversations online. That's all it is, all right? So think about how you converse in the real world and translate that into conversations in the online world. And each social media channel has a different kind of vibe. So your conversation's going to be a little bit different. Facebook's a party, LinkedIn's a networking event, yeah? Twitter's a bit of a Snapchat, you know? Get it out there quick and fast, quick and dirty. No, it's not dirty. It doesn't have to be dirty. That's weird. Take that back. But, you know, look at the channel and figure out what the environment is and enter the conversation. Start conversations, join conversations. Be chatty. I reckon you'd be good at that. Jen, you're a designer. Number two, be clear on what each channel is for. So, you know, like with Facebook, you've heard me talk about the Small Business Big Marketing Facebook before. That's where I share the lighter side of marketing. So, you know, Jen, have a think about what role your Facebook could be for the designer's agency. You might make fun observations around design. You might ask fun questions, ask people, you know, if Apple designed a car, what features would it have? And get a conversation happening that way. There is a great Facebook by a guy called Todd Design, and he shares some just the most beautiful designed things in the world. It can be furniture, cars, jewelry, pens, whatever. But he kind of curates all that stuff and shares it. It's beautiful. So, just be clear on each channel and jump in, right? But if you're going to jump in, Jen, be consistent. Okay, so once you've gone, okay, I'm going to open up a Facebook and I know exactly what role Facebook has in my business, then be consistent. Be in there once a day, you know, 5 minutes, just asking a question, sharing something interesting, being part of the conversation, and go to other people's Facebooks and be part of their conversation around design as well. And you can find them in the search box of Facebook. The second question, how to grow your customer list when you're on a shoestring. Jen, on your website, add a rego form, start building your list that way. Go to something like MailChimp or Aweber or Campaign Monitor. Add a rego form, ask people for their email address, first name, in exchange for something. Just like I do over at Small Business Big Marketing. Give me your first name and email address and I'll give you a 20-minute video I've created about 10 marketing wake-up calls. Incredibly valuable, high perceived value to you and at a relatively low cost to me. And that's the way it should be in permission marketing, because you want to create something that is really valuable to your list. So Jen, I'm suggesting you create an ebook. Maybe an ebook about how to get the best work from a designer. And it's, you know, a 10, 12 page ebook that goes through tips and tricks on working with a designer. Another one might be 10 secrets to the ultimate logo, you know, and you can give examples of great logos you've seen and observations. You know, another one maybe what we can learn from the great logos of the world, what small businesses can learn from the great logos of the world. So create an ebook, and when someone gives you their email address, give them that ebook, and you can set all that up automatically on those programs, those software programs that I mentioned. You can also direct people from Facebook. So on your Facebook, you can have a little app that sits along the top of your timeline that says, you know, grab our free ebook, and people can register there and then. Aweber and MailChimp have plugins into Facebook, so it can all happen there and then. So, Jen, great questions. In terms of outsourcing, we're going to tackle that whole thing with the interview, the fireside chat I have with Chris Ducker shortly. But my departing advice for you, Jennifer, is can you afford not to outsource?
Timbo, Oyster here from Content Grasshopper. Listening to the podcast, the last one where you gave some advice to your Irish friend who's a personal trainer who was looking or asking for some advice for mics. Occurred to me that maybe that lav mic, the Rode lav mic, might not be the best solution, particularly if he wants to actually be recording himself doing exercises and rolling around on the ground in the gym and weights and around the oval and all that sort of stuff. So I do have a one of those Rode lav mics, and they're great. He can get an extension cord down at somewhere like Dick Smith. You can get sort of 3.5-5 meter extension cords, but thought potentially a better solution for him might be the Belkin live action mic, which is essentially the same connection, but it's a little shotgun boom mic, powered by a AAA battery, so it picks up great sound, and he could put the phone down somewhere with the mic turned on and record himself doing whatever exercise and instructions and stuff like that. Another product he might be interested in is a cool little product called BuzzCard, BuzzCard.com, not .com.au, but they are an Australian company based up near the Central Coast, I think, but they have a great app that you can download. You do have to sign up for a for an account, but you can try it out with a free trial. But essentially what you do is you set up your intro sequence and your outro sequence with music and logos and little animations and stuff like that, and you set up your watermark. Once you've taken your video, you just upload it to the app and download it, and it automatically adds your intro and your outro sequence and your watermark over what you've just recorded. So that might be something that's perfect for him, gives you the ability to email it out and also directly publish to his Facebook page and his YouTube site. So a couple options there. Thought I might share. I will speak to you soon. Keep up the good work. Cheers, buddy.
Hey, thanks so much, Daniel, for that great advice, and thanks for tuning into the show. I know Daniel's been a long-time listener. Now, I'm going to get on my soapbox and have a bit of a rant. I was at a meeting yesterday, and meetings go for too long. That's rant number one. Ask yourself, do you really need to meet? We have this funny kind of default 1 hour meeting expectation, don't we? Do you find that when you're setting a meeting or when someone sets a meeting with you, it's like it's going to be 1 hour, 9 to 10, you know, 3:30 to 4:30. Some meetings can happen so much quicker. Some meetings don't need to happen at all. And in fact, my guest today, Chris, with his meetings, he has no chairs and no table. He has stand-up meetings and demands that they're 20 minutes long, and he explains how he runs those meetings very shortly. Very, very interesting. So first rant is about meetings. Now, when in a meeting, or anywhere really, but I was in this meeting yesterday where people were sharing really good ideas, and, you know, when good ideas are being thrown around, you've got to build on them. So, and what I was finding is someone would go, hey, here's a good idea, blah, 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 blah. And then all of a sudden, someone would kick in and go off on another tangent instead of acknowledging what that previous person had said and or building on what it is they said before actually moving off to a completely another tangent. So many things get lost when that happens. And I just was like, it was in this meeting going, really? I kind of wanted to speak up, but I thought, everyone's going to think, oh, Timbo's a bit grumpy today. But I probably should have, but I'm airing my grievances now. So do you need meetings? Do they need to be as long as they are scheduled for? Could they be knocked out a lot quicker? And when you're in them, listen and build on what people are saying, and not just kind of race off to another topic that is important to you but might not be important to the other person. So that is my rant. I will now get off my soapbox. Righto, we are joined now by Chris Ducker. Chris, in 2009, how's this? He was running a 300-person call center in the Philippines. He's an Englishman living in the Philippines. Life was completely out of control. Got to the point where he wasn't wanting to get out of bed for anyone. And he was in a bit of a dark space. But he made a pact at the start of 2010 with the help of his beautiful wife to remove himself from his business as much as he could within the coming 12 months. Well, he absolutely succeeded in doing that. He's going to explain how and how you can too. So this episode really is for the tired, overwhelmed business owner. And we've been promising a bit of an outsourcing discussion for a long time. It's bigger than that, though. It's about being less of a control freak like we all are. You know, it's my way or the highway, and freeing ourselves up to get on with life. Chris Ducker, virtual star finder, welcome finally to Small Business Big Marketing.
Mate, I'm so stoked to be here. This has been a long while in the making, this podcast session.
Far too long. Our listeners won't know, but we pass like ships in the virtual night via social media and via a group of friends, and it's great to finally chat. Now, I'm kind of titling this episode, this fireside chat, Chris, the light and the load episode, because that's what I want to do so badly for the small business owner listening to this show. We're embarking on a new year, an exciting new year ahead in terms of running a small business and marketing a small business. But there is a lot of tired small business owners out there. And from what I understand, you were a very tired small business owner up until about 3 years ago.
Yeah, I was knackered, plain and simple. I own a few different businesses. The big business is not one that really a lot of people know me for. It's a call center. We have almost 300 staff. And I was, you know, up until probably, right up until literally the end of 2009, I was doing 6 days a week, 14-hour days. I was completely burned out. I it was over that Christmas and New Year period of 2009 going into 2010 that I realized something just had to change, mate. I mean, plain simple. Like,
what was your lowest point?
My lowest point was starting to hate my business, because I became an entrepreneur because I hated my job. So here I was with a business that was a multi-7-figure business at that point. After only a few years of being in business, and I had hit burnout. There were some mornings where I literally didn't want to get out of bed. I was like, I couldn't even fathom the idea of going into the office, sort of thing. And that was, that's definitely the low point, you know, really hitting that wall like a sack of potatoes and realizing right there and then that something's got to change. And what happened was my wife, and she's so good at reading. It's scary, isn't it? How good they are at that sort of stuff.
They are magicians at it.
She's so good at reading me. And she booked us in for a 3-night stay at the Shangri-La Resort here in Cebu in the Philippines. So it's only about a 30-minute drive away from where we live. So we had a little staycation. It was December 26, 27, 28. And those 3 days, we didn't really do anything in regards to talking about business and what was going on, stuff like that. All we really kind of really focused in on and off throughout the course of that 3 days was putting a plan in place to get my butt out of the business day to day. And so January 2010, I launched my first ever blog, which was Virtual Business Lifestyle. And the focus there was to remove myself. It was a public goal that I set for myself to remove myself from the business day to day by the end of 2010.
So is it like it was the blog idea a sort of cathartic way for you to say, okay, you know, it's like when you express your goals publicly, you feel more committed?
Yeah, it was like that. I mean, I had become a big reader of blogs, particularly small business entrepreneur marketing type blog. So, you know, Seth Godin, you know, those kind of guys. And I figured, well, you know, I'm not the only small business owner in the world that's doing these kind of crazy hours and is burnt out the way he is. Maybe I can help a few other people break free as well at the same time. And so what I did is that 1 year long goal, I then broke down into mini goals, which ended up being monthly goals. So I would do a monthly report at the end of every month talking about what I'd done that month to remove myself one bit at a time from the business. And I actually
I just get clear? Were you absolutely doing this blog for yourself? You'd read a lot of other blogs, but were you doing it for yourself, or was there an intention of building an audience?
I mean, initially I was doing it for myself, but it became very apparent very, very quickly that there were a lot of people in the same position. Yeah. The audience just took off. I mean, within 3 months I had, you know, between anything between 5,000 to 10,000 unique visitors on a monthly basis. And my posts were just getting shared like crazy. 4 or 5 months in, I started my first podcast because I figured that, you know, by the end of the year, I was going to have all this extra time on my hands. What was I going to do? Just sit on my ass and not do anything? No, I was going to start other businesses. And so I started looking at the whole lifestyle business concept of being able to run a business from virtually anywhere, as well as having that large brick and mortar business as well. That's when I started really talking about the virtual staff that I had been working with at that point for years. I mean, a lot of them just on a freelancer basis. And I kind of, by the end of that year, not only had I broken free and hit the goal, I had become somewhat of an authority on the subject of outsourcing and VAs and building a virtual team. I had gotten my first speaking gig in the online business world at Blog World in Vegas. And it all kind of just catapulted from there. But it all came out of realizing, and I think this is one of the big struggles that a lot of small business owners have, is that they know they're close to burnout or they've already hit it. They know they've hit the wall.
Oh, mate, some of the emails I get, some of the small business owners I meet when I speak, bring a tear to a glass eye.
Absolutely. And, you know, they know it, but they don't have... A lot of them don't have the drive to make the changes, or they've
probably got the drive. They haven't got the energy,
right.
And they may not know what to do. And when I've found myself personally in that overwhelm, it's hard enough to kind of keep the ship going versus, my God, you know, hang on. So I've got to hand all this over. That requires a whole lot of, I've got to find people, I've got to train people, I've got to trust people, I've got to, oh, too hard, I'll keep doing it myself and I'll just burn out.
Right, yeah.
You know, that's. I'm guessing that's the conversation that many have. And I was saying to you before we hit record, you know, like a lot of people listen to this show kicking and screaming as I drag them into the new world of modern world of marketing and of small business. And, you know, as much as I say, one of my kind of my mantras is there's never been a better time to market and to own a small business. It doesn't mean that there's not a whole lot of people doing it tough. So I think there's probably a whole lot of people listening to us right now going, yep, that's me.
Yeah. Waving the white flag as they're tuning yeah, in literally, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Totally. So tell me, Chris, you were 2010. So at the start of 2010, you've gone away 3 days. You've still got the 300 staff call center in the Philippines. You've still got a couple of other businesses, but you've gone away what I'd call a circuit breaker, 3 days, smart wifey, well done to her. You've come back. It's only 3 days. You've decided to start a blog to share your thoughts and to make yourself accountable in the public forum. But you still had to go back to work at the 300 staff call center, didn't you?
Yeah, yeah.
So, you just found the chutzpah, I suppose, the chutzpah to keep going. But how did you keep going, and where was the tipping point to go where you started to see the light?
Well, the big thing for me, when I sat down, and one of the first things I did to start removing myself, and I was, you know, I'm your typical micromanaging pain in the butt
yeah.
business owner boss, right? Yeah. So I was involved with the recruiting, I was involved with the training, I was involved with the operations, I was involved with the IT setup. Here's the thing. I wasn't running a business anymore. I had become the business ultimately. And so I realized that, and I started breaking down those ridiculously long 14, 15, sometimes 16-hour days into blocks of work. What was I doing in the office that day? And so I carried on for about a week or so with those long hours, and I really made a note of everything that I had done. And the big, big, big time sucker for me was email. What was going on was I was such a micromanager that I was getting copied into virtually every email from all of my staff.
Ooh,
and I'm not saying 300 members of staff were emailing me. There was only a bulk of maybe 30 or 40 people were in different positions across the company. But I was sat in Outlook on my laptop for an average of 8 hours a day. That was how insane it was. And the moment that realization hit me, I said to myself, man, this is absolutely mental. Like, I've got to change this immediately. So I did one thing that I know so many entrepreneurs have an issue with when it comes to email, is I went cold turkey on it.
Ooh. Ooh, how'd that feel?
Bloody brilliant. Scary as hell, but also brilliant as well. But no, I did. I went completely cold turkey.
What's that look like?
It looked like me telling everyone except my operations manager and my HR manager that I didn't want to get an email from them anymore. So it went from 8 hours a day to about 3 hours a day, because I was basically the marketing machine for the business as well. So there were prospects and new customers I was bringing on board and all that stuff as well. So and it's now down, three almost 4 years later, it's now down to I spend maybe an hour a day in email, because I also have a VA and this is the other thing. Not only do I go cold turkey and get myself taken out of all those email loops, but now I have someone else, brace yourself, I have actually someone else go into my email box before I start work in the morning and clear out the average of 200 emails a day that I get and chop that down to about 30 or 40.
I had a fellow who is a member who's in the Small Business Big Marketing Forum who specializes in this 8-step process. And there's an interview with him literally going through how you get to that point, just that point alone. And look, I'm not there, so I'm not saying, it's an unreal point. Love to be there, but to get to that point alone must be incredible, but email, it's an intangible thing, but has such a weight about it.
Yeah.
Carry it around some carry it around like a badge of honor. Others carry it around like, the heaviest rock available. I saw this interview with, I won't say who, but it might be hard to guess because there's not that many airlines in Australia. The CEO of one of the airlines in Australia a couple of weeks ago was quoted in a Sunday magazine saying he gets up at 3 a.m. on a Sunday and does his emails.
Madness.
Oh, mate, that's an intelligent man.
What's he doing that for? He's a nutcase. He's not intelligent.
Tough guy. Tough guy.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those, it's just one of those, focal points that a lot of entrepreneurs just can't let go of. And I think a lot of it is fear of not really knowing what's happening with that person in your inbox. But I think also a lot of it is just micromanagement. We are a very strange breed, us entrepreneurs. We really do. We stand out from the crowd. We really do. And it's one of the things that makes us so special and so important for society, but it's also, one of the banes of our existence as well,
Chris, there's a whole lot of people listening to this. They're business owners, they're plumbers, they're vets, they're accountants.
Wait a minute, you let accountants listen to your show?
Oh, yeah, mate, crazy accountants. Say hello, accountants. Yeah. No, lots of crazy accountants in Australia too, that's just how we roll.
Yeah.
But, they're listening in, they're on the tools, mate. They are just, they cannot extract themselves from that micromanagement. In fact, many of them believe that, they are the business. The business couldn't run without them. I only answered a listener question about 3 episodes ago from a guy who has an idea for a passion project that he's so wants to bring to life, but he's got this direct mail business and he can't step out of it. Or according to him, he can't step out of it. So right now, there's a whole lot of people going, it's all right, it's all very good for you, Chris Ducker, who's living in the Philippines and has got his head around this whole virtual thing, but it's not for me. What do you say to them?
It's a tough one to answer, because I think that a lot of people, they truly do want to step away from that micromanaging kind of role, right? You've got to open up your eyes. You've got to understand that nobody's got a monopoly on good ideas and tactics and techniques and tips and, whatever else. And you've got to open up, you've got to try things. You've got to get out of your comfort zone and try things out.
So when you kind of like you struggled with that answer, did you struggle with it because for some people it's not possible, they have to be there, or because it is a mental, it requires a massive mind shift, kind of mental leap into this new world, this outsourcing space?
I think it's a combination of the two, I think. I know that sounds a bit of a funny answer, because, just because you get involved with outsourcing, or just because you stop micromanaging and you switch on to the more new age way of doing business, becoming more mobile, taking your email to the cloud instead of being stuck in Outlook and all that sort of stuff, it doesn't mean you have to take yourself out of the business. It just means you're becoming more productive in the way that you actually produce that business and run that business. And I think that, you know, there's a couple of simple activities that I get my coaching clients and people that I, speak in front of on stage. Like, there's one particular activity that I call my three lists to freedom. Do you want me to break it down for you?
Go for it.
Okay. All right. So, and this is a game changer, and it's such a simple exercise to do that anyone, even the accountants, can handle this one. All right. I'm not going to rag on accountants anymore. They probably
No. I'd be careful.
I'm a horrible guy now all of a sudden. If you're an accountant out there, no, I do it in jest.
Yeah.
But so it's a very simple exercise, and it's an utter game changer. So this is the way we do it. You get a piece of paper or your iPad or a whiteboard or whatever, and you draw a couple of lines down it, creating three different columns, okay? And we're going to make three separate lists that will ultimately become a roadmap that we can follow to start getting rid of all these tasks that we're having to handle on a daily basis, all right? The first column is a list of all the things that you don't like doing. Okay. This is a list of stuff that, you know, you'll procrastinate until the cows come home, and you'll just put them off right until the end of the day and rush them. And a lot of the time you'll make mistakes, or they won't be done properly, haphazardly, that sort of stuff. So list of all the stuff that you don't like doing. Second list is a list of all the things that you can't do. Now, this one requires a little bit more letting go of mindset wise, because I call it superhero syndrome. A lot of entrepreneurs suffer from this syndrome, and that is that we believe that we're better than everyone else out there, that we can do the job better than everyone else. And because of that, we don't let go of these kind of tasks naturally. But the fact of the matter is that if you're a vet, or if you're a plumber, or if you're a grocery store owner, or if you own a franchise, I wasn't going to bring them up again. You had to go there though, didn't you?
Yeah, I do.
But I mean, you know, even if you, let's say you're a dentist, you're running a dentist practice, you know, you're a dentist. Why are you trying to design a website? Mm-hmm. Why are you trying to do that? Oh, there's somebody else out there that A, is going to be able to do it better than you, B, is going to be able to do it faster than you, and C, will be able to actually guide you through the process of developing the best possible website for your dental practice, right?
Can I answer that? One of the answers is because it's cheaper if I do it myself. But one of the things that I argue, and it's a limiting belief, because one of the things that I argue is that a lot of this kind of the new way of marketing ain't as expensive as you think it is, particularly if you embrace outsourcing anyway and build what I call the virtual marketing team. So that whole superhero syndrome can, you knock that one on the head.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we've got two columns so far, don't like doing, can't do. What's the third one?
And the third one is the one that needs the most amount of thought. And this is a list of all the things that as a business owner, you feel you shouldn't actually be doing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, these can be tasks that you can do very well. These can also be tasks that you actually enjoy doing. But as the business owner, should you be doing it? Can you be spending your time doing something that is more financially beneficial for you and your business? Strategizing for growth, creating new product services, spending time with 20% of your top clients, that sort of type of stuff, right? So those become the three lists of freedom, because once you put them together very clearly on that piece of paper, you ultimately have a blueprint or a roadmap that you can follow to start outsourcing tasks.
So let's get clear. We've got don't like doing, can't do, and shouldn't be doing. We've got the, once we've completed that list, what do you do with each of those three columns? Is each of those three columns then to be handed over to someone?
Well, I mean, you know, at first, because of that superhero syndrome, the chances of you just giving those three lists to somebody and say, take care of that for me, is going to be very highly unlikely, right? So, you know, I always say, you know, when you start outsourcing, when you start delegating tasks out virtually, the best places to start are places like Elance and Odesk, Freelancer, those kind of websites, because they allow you to dip your toe in the virtual.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can start off with something really, really easy, like getting some transcription work done, or getting a logo design or a landing page put together and developed for your WordPress website, or, you know, whatever. It doesn't matter. You know, something really simple, a kind of a per project basis or a per task outsourced basis. And you can do that for quite some time. Even I personally still outsource tasks on a task by task basis quite regularly, because I don't need that kind of person full time. So why should I pay for them full time? Right. So a perfect example is transcriptions. I get a lot of transcriptions done of videos and podcasts and things like that, but I don't have enough work to keep somebody in full time employment in regards to that. So once you do dip your toe in the water there and you become more kind of tuned into the idea of working virtually with somebody and conversing via email or maybe a project management system such as Basecamp or Asana or Huddle or something like that, you can then start thinking about potentially bringing on board your first full-time virtual staff member. And in my eyes, in my opinion, that has to be a general virtual assistant, or a GVA as I call them. Because these GVAs, they become your right arm. They will do everything from online research to, you know, keyword research to putting together your latest blog post in WordPress for you to come in, make final couple of changes and hit the publish button. They can upload your YouTube videos. They can upload your podcast episodes, create all the links from the show notes for you. You know, all this sort of type of very simple but time-consuming tasks, Tim. This is the thing.
Now, there's some tasks. I mean, they're the tasks that, you know, I have doing on a daily basis. But let's just bring it back to the dentist, the plumber, who's not doing a podcast, who's not updating his WordPress, probably should be updating his or her WordPress, by the way, because keeping a website fresh is a good thing and many don't. But what are some of those tasks that a general VA can do for someone who isn't necessarily marketing online?
Great question. So, I mean, you know, ultimately, it's going to come down to you making those lists first, right? Once those lists are in place, you've got a clear, you know, a very clear, you know, really, I mean, it's a roadmap, right? So once those things are out, sure. So, but I mean, to answer the question more directly, everything from, okay, so you're talking about not doing work online. Let's say you don't do anything online at all.
Yeah, it could be setting appointments, inputting, I mean, we end up with 20 business cards in our pocket that need inputting somewhere. I guess taking photos of them and sending the photos to the VA to then put into some kind of CRM or travel, I guess.
See, you're already going down the list. You're going down the list. Things like database management, your CRM management, definitely, you know, scanning, you know, you taking a quick photo of cards or, you know, that sort of type of stuff. One of the things that I do with my VA or one of my VAs is I take photos of my credit card purchases, my receipts, and she then puts them into a spreadsheet that I can then cross-reference when my credit card statement comes in. So it's just little things like that. Hotel flight bookings, definitely. Managing your calendar, definitely. Filtering your email. I don't care if you're not doing business online. You've got an email account, I'm sure. So managing and filtering your email. If you're a dentist, if you're a plumber, you should have a Facebook page, to help sort of market yourself locally. They can do a lot of stuff on that for you. Booking your appointments, double-checking your appointments, reminding clients. And patience and that sort of type of thing of those clients as well, whether it be via a quick email or a quick phone call, that kind of stuff.
Okay, so these are special people too. You know, like that's there's a broad range of tasks there mm-hmm. that we as small business owners, we're doing, which is quite hilarious when you really look at it. And like if you were to complete those three columns that you suggested, you know, you look at that and you go, you know, how many hats do we wear?
Yeah.
You know, and so finding a general virtual assistant who can do this as well, that wouldn't be any mean feat. And I myself have been down this track where I have gone through virtual assistants to varying degrees of success. But it's like anything, you know, it's like employing someone in your office face to face versus employing someone overseas. Same thing. You've got to get it right. So to that end, I'm guessing there's a brief. And we're going to talk, listeners, by the way. Don't stress, because we're going to share, you know, some play. Chris has already spoken about some places to find these people, but we'll talk further about that. But let's talk about getting the brief right. So if the idea of a GVA is a good one, and I think it is, Chris, what's the brief look like when you're casting the net?
Well, I mean, you know, you've got to put together a proper solid job description, right? So, you know, if you're talking about hiring somebody full-time to handle that sort of stuff, you know, one of the biggest issues is that people will assume immediately that virtual assistants know how to do everything right out of the box. Yes. I've seen it over and over again. And, you know, the fact of the matter is that is not the case. The other big problem that I see in the outsourcing world, and you know, you can thank the so-called internet marketing gurus online that talk a load of rubbish just to make money, for this particular issue, is one VA cannot do everything, right? This is why we have different types of virtual workers. It's because you cannot assume that one VA is going to be able to, you know, manage your email, upload your videos, edit those videos, you know, do all your SEO, handle your website creation, all this stuff. That's what I call the super VA, and the super VA doesn't exist.
an android.
Right. Yeah, exactly. They just don't exist. No, so really, I mean, it comes down to putting together, you know, and it really is a bit of a brain dump to begin with. And you can jot all those tasks down to begin with, but then you've got to become more realistic. You can't expect the super worker in the real world, and therefore they're not going to be there in the virtual world, that's for sure. So, you know, the admin and you know, should we say the admin and the blogging tasks that are out there, things like checking and transcribing your voicemail, sending out, you know, client invoices or reminders, you know, moderating your blog comments, doing your online research, creating reports. Another thing that I do, one of my VAs. So one of my top productivity rules is none of my meetings, my face-to-face meetings with my staff, last more than 20 minutes, and there's no chairs in the room.
Oh, I like that. I like that.
I got rid of them from my conference room. There's no chairs there. The only time there's ever chairs in that room is when we have guests, like clients come into town. And
what's your thinking? Because people don't want to stand for too long, so they're happy to make it a quick meeting.
Exactly.
Yeah. And how funny is it? Like when we schedule meetings, how many times I've got a meeting after this and I had the diary appointment come through on my Google Calendar and it was like 4:30 to 5:30. And you know what? We can nail whatever we're going to be talking about in this meeting in 15 minutes, but whoever set this meeting up is just, it's this default 1 hour. Mm-hmm. So, you know, productivity tip right there is to, you know, get over those need for 1 hour meetings. Get over the need for meetings unless it's like mission critical.
Yeah, absolutely. But then, you know, what I do is so that everybody that is present at the meeting is ridiculously present. There's nobody there taking minutes or notes. Nobody. We hit the record button on my iPhone. I record the entire 20-minute meeting, and then that audio file goes off to a transcriptionist who then transcribes those notes, and everybody gets a complete transcription from that meeting. So they can read through the entire meeting, what was discussed and who said what. Love it.
And is that not doubling up? Feels like, where's the efficiency in that? So you're at a meeting?
No, because I want the people that are in that meeting to be present, to be there in the conversation, not looking down on the computer or on notepads or anything like that.
So they might not even read those notes, but the fact is they know that it's being captured. If they miss something, they can go back to them. But the fact that they're present, the fact that they're not leaning into a screen, they're not writing, they're probably going to get it first go.
Absolutely. And I should also note that I only have one meeting a month with my management team.
Nice.
That's it. So, you know, it's not like we're doing these every week. You know what I mean? So it works well. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff that, you know, I've developed and I put in place over the course of the last few years. And I never stopped him. I never stopped looking for little changes I can make to try and tweak processes and particularly the automation and the system side of the business.
Mm-hmm. So, Chris, to that point that there is no superhuman virtual assistant, like there is no superhuman employee in the real world, not just the virtual world. And there are, I mean, again, going back to the three columns, there is going to be a variety of tasks, some of which are absolutely repetitive, brain-numbingly boring, others which require thought, strategy, knowledge of technology, and everything in between. So does that all of a sudden mean that as you slowly become comfortable with outsourcing and developing trust in handing over passwords and things like that, we'll talk about that in a minute, does that mean then that you end up having a number of virtual assistants who are good at particular things?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the overall goal should be to build a team. That GVA is the center of the team. After a year or maybe 2 years, they'll become the project manager. Because what will happen is, and this goes back to, you know, what I was talking about, taking myself out of the business, I was in all those different areas. By the end of 2010, by the way, I'd hired six different people to be present at my facility so that I could truly remove myself from the business. Mm-hmm. So I had to hire six people to take myself out of the business. And the same can be said with a virtual team as well. But here's the danger with a virtual team. Because it's virtual, you do tend to, and because obviously the cost of outsourcing is very attractive to small business owners, particularly those that are bootstrapping, you might tend to hire a little more than you really need to. Or maybe a little bit more frequently than you truly need to. And because of that, what happens is you go from the business owner that's working with one or two VAs to the business owner that's working with four or five VAs, but now he's no longer a business owner. He's a manager of people. So you need to, at that point, take yourself out of that process of managing that team of five to make sure that you don't lose the freedom you've built up. And the way to do that is to get a project manager in place, usually the GVA that you give a shot and promotion at. And then you just work with the GVA and the GVA works for the rest of the team. But yes, the goal should be to build a team of skilled workers across the board so that you can just say, right, podcast, that goes to Mike. Boom, video, that goes to Shelley. You know, boom, 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 boom. And that's just the way it works. Or the way it should work anyway.
Let's talk about trust. Again, you know, there's trust in employing someone face-to-face. People, I think, have a massive, one of the massive blockages to small business owners not going down this path is that, oh, going to hand over my passwords and they're going to get access to my information and this and that. And, you know, what do you say to that?
Again, it's fear. You know, this is fear of the unknown, fear of letting go is what it is. We don't want to let go. Now, obviously, you've got to be smart about it. You're not going to give them access to your PayPal account, not straight away anyway. As a perfect example, I've had the same financial director since day one of the business. I knew her for 4 years before I hired her. So I've actually known this lady now for almost 12 years, okay? And she only just got access to my PayPal account about 6 months ago.
Right. Yeah, I think that would be the last password you would give out, if ever.
I mean, but the funny thing, Tim, is that she has access to all of my business accounts and there's way more money in them than there is in my PayPal account. So go figure, right? Go figure. But there's something about, you're right, there's something about that online sort of type of world where people do get a little bit more cagey. The email is a big one. You know, that even stuff like giving up access to your Twitter account, your Facebook page, and all this sort of stuff can be scary for a lot of people. But ultimately, there's only one way to build trust, and that is to start letting go. But you don't, you know, you don't literally have to give them your personal password. You know, you can cloak that with, you know, services such as, you know, LastPass or OnePassword.com and that sort of stuff.
I love LastPass. My old mate Mickey Cullen introduced me to LastPass and I've never looked back. And for those who are wondering, game changer. So quite simply, listeners, LastPass, I think it's $1 a month.
Yeah, and, it's madness.
It's madness. And you only ever need one password for your LastPass. And then if I wanted to give Chris access to my Facebook, I would share him access to my Facebook. He'd never see the password. And if I wanted to retract it, I could do it in a heartbeat by just unsharing access and not having to change passwords or anything. And yeah, it is beautiful. So, yeah, so, okay, so we've got through the trust thing and the fear thing, and we've got our toe in the water, so we're trying something, we're getting something outsourced. That's a good thing. We're starting to build a virtual team. Now, one of the other things that I hear, and I think you'd hear a lot And I reckon Tim Ferriss, with the book, The 4-Hour Workweek of many years ago, is kind of guilty of establishing this thought, is that so many business owners who hear about virtual teams and outsourcing think it's about finding the $1 an hour man in India.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And I still, now that is an old perception to some, to people like you and I who live in this space, you more than me, but it's still a perception out there amongst small business land. And it's, you know, let's address it. It's not about finding the $1 man in India. It's finding good people, A players somewhere in the world.
Yeah, absolutely. I was on another podcast interview a couple of days ago and somebody asked me where is the best place to find the best VAs? And I said, well, you're thinking about it in the wrong way. It should just be, how do I find the best VA? Because, you know, there's so many different companies, there's so many different VA or types of VAs in so many different countries around the world, that it should just be about finding the best person for that task or the best person for that role, that full-time role. Now, the Philippines has got a stronghold on the offshore or the overseas type of VA setup, mainly because of their really high quality language or English language potential. Obviously, there are some people here who can't speak a word of English, but I mean, the vast majority of anybody that
there
was,
are in Australia,
yeah.
Too.
Yeah, actually,
I could be accused of it,
mate, in London as well. If you've not walked through the markets in East London, you don't know what I'm talking about. But yeah, you're absolutely right.
I have listeners email me sometimes going, "What were you talking about, Timbo?"
But I mean, the Philippines, you know, the communication level of the Filipino worker today is much higher than anyone that I've ever even attempted to work with in India. You know, I've worked with VAs all around the world. And I can say to you that working with Filipino GVAs is way, just way more easier, much less stress than working with somebody in India. I don't know. And I don't mean anything bad towards the, you know, the Indian people or anything, but they're just, their mindsets just doesn't seem to be in it.
Yeah. Well, I think there is the education in the Philippines is strong. From an Australian point of view, they're 2 hours behind. So there's
right.
A kind of nice time difference, which may or may not be important to someone. But go on, were you going to say something else?
I was going to say, you know, the thing with the Indians, however, is that, you know, they're, you know, and obviously there's good and bad apples in this basket, obviously, but, you know, their SEO work has been very strong for very, very long. So anything search engine optimization related, they're a bit of a hotspot. Now, the one area that I've seen develop really well in the last couple of years has been Eastern Europe, particularly with things like
online design,
yeah,
and development.
Design or web development, and now really more so over the last year, mobile app development. Everything's going to Eastern Europe. You can get a mobile app designed, developed, built, launched, everything done for $5,000 out of somebody from, you know, somewhere in Eastern Europe. Whereas, you know, if you're going to work with somebody in the United States, it costs you 6 times that amount. So, you know, it's all about finding the right person for the job above and beyond everything else.
I want to finish up shortly and just talk money and what you can expect to pay. But before we do, we've spoken a lot about the GVA, the general virtual assistant, covering off different general aspects of your business. One thing I've spoken occasionally about on this show, Chris, is this concept of the virtual marketing team. And remember, this is a marketing show, so I have to go down this path.
Do it. Love it.
But the idea of, so one of the limiting beliefs that many small business owners have around creating great marketing is that it's going to cost them a fortune. And the idea of a virtual marketing team addresses that. And what it means is you can have Jono over in the States handling your Google AdWords. You can have Mary over in the UK doing your transcription. You can have Shirley over in New Zealand building your website or writing your copy. You know, like you are just building this virtual marketing team of people around the world. What's the question there? Do the same concepts apply? The same place? Do you find these people in the same places that you've previously mentioned? And does the team get managed in the same way?
Yeah, pretty much so. I mean, you know, you've got to hire somebody. I mean, when you're talking about marketing, a lot of the stuff can be taught, but a lot of small business owners that I work with, they want the experience level to be at a certain point if they're hiring somebody in regards to marketing. Let's talk Facebook, right? So, you know, there are certain things that work well on Facebook, and there's certain things that are just not even, there's no point in doing them. The small business owner out there, even if they're decent at marketing in the real world, print ad media, billboards, radio, TV, maybe the yellow pages, who knows if they're back in 1989. But I mean,
yeah, that's right. Let me just hop in my time machine. Hang on.
But it was, you know, it honestly speaking, you should be looking to hire these people with a certain experience level, which means that you are going to have to pay a little bit more for, you know, for that type of person compared to somebody that wouldn't have a lot of experience, right? But I mean, you know, for an example, a general virtual assistant, who a lot of them are really good with social media, you know, you could hire somebody full time for $500 a month US. You know, but then when you start, you know, going down the road of experienced web developers, you know, $800-$900 US. These are Philippine prices, by the way. You know, I recently had a website redesigned, which will go live in a couple of weeks from now. And I worked with somebody in Eastern Europe, because I tried working with somebody here in the Philippines and he just couldn't quite get the angle that I wanted to come from. So I ended up spending, and I kid you not, twice the amount of money to get that project completed, because I needed it completed. I didn't want to have to micromanage the living hell out of it. And it was one of the easiest online design jobs I've ever encountered. The guy was just on it. So it is about, you know, you truly do get what you pay for.
Yeah, you do.
But when you're talking about building a team, you know, that's more than just one person or one project. That's potentially maybe a full-time thing. And that's why the attraction to outsource overseas is so high, because the numbers are so much lower. You know, a full-time content creator or a writer here in the Philippines will cost you $500 or $600 a month. Whereas if you were to get somebody in Australia or the US or whatever, you know, doing that stuff for you, it's going to be a couple of grand probably. So, you know, money does come into it. Let's not beat around the bush. Money does come into it. But I think, you know, those entrepreneurs that are successful with their outsourcing efforts, they learn how to let go quick. They understand that there's not one person to do everything. They appreciate the ability to be able to utilize an entire team of skilled workers, and they don't penny pinch and they don't screw people over when it comes to money. And I think, you know, that handful of kind of that kind of handful of tips are kind of pretty standard stuff, but a lot of people, because it's virtual and it's in an arm's length, they think they can get away with stuff, you know.
Chris, gold, mate. I love the fact that you've embraced this world and now you're sharing it with others. It's where the world's headed. It doesn't mean that we're all going to be outsourcing everything in 5 years' time, but it's just an option. It's like, you know, when I talk, you know, it's like online marketing hasn't replaced offline marketing.
No, not
it's
at
just,
all.
It's complemented. They run alongside each other and they're beautifully complementary. And likewise, it's just the ability. One thing that I've found with outsourcing is that so it allows you to get stuff done that you might have not got done locally because it was too expensive, right, or you didn't know someone or whatever it is.
Yep.
But, you know, the idea of being able to go to a website, say like 99 Designs, and get a brochure design for a few $100, you go, well, I'll do that. I'll see what it looks like. If I'm happy with it, I'll run with it. And so it allows you to test more things as well. So now, Chris, I'm going to send people over to chrisducker.com, which is your personal website and blog. You've got Virtual Star Finder, which is your business that helps people identify virtual assistants with your assistants. And you've got a book coming out real soon too, haven't you? What's it called?
It's called Virtual Freedom. And it is,
like that.
This is it. I've put everything into this book. I'm not holding back anything. It's all there. It's a complete organized brain dump of everything from, you know, where to find VAs, how to hire them properly. I even give interview questions. You know, I mean, I've really dumbed it down so anybody can pick this thing up. You know, hiring, training, managing, motivating, the whole kit and caboodle.
Love it. Mate, as soon as it's out, let us know and I'll let the tribe know. Chris Ducker, thanks for being on Small Business Big Marketing.
Timbo, pleasure, mate.
You got to love that song by the Soup Dragons. Now, I hope that interview, that fireside chat with Chris, has given you a little bit of a glimmer of how you can change the way you go about running your business in the coming 12 months. Three learnings for me: beware the superhero syndrome. Boy, oh boy, have we all got a bit of that, us small business owners. In fact, right now, I've got the undies on the outside. That's how much I suffer from it. Us small business owners just can't and shouldn't do everything. And I think it's a really interesting exercise. Point two really here is to create that list. You know, what don't you like doing? What can't you do? And what shouldn't you be doing? And just see how many of those puppies you can tick off and pass over to someone else. And to that end, my point three learning is dip your toe in the water. So if this whole outsourcing thing is a bit freakazoid to you, then outsource something simple. Find a transcriber and get them to transcribe some audio that you've created. Or find a VA and just pay them by the hour to input all the business cards that you've ever collected that are sitting in the bottom drawer into an Excel spreadsheet or to a program like MailChimp and start building that list like Jen wants to, who asked that question earlier. So three big learnings there, team. We've got to do it. It's part of your 2014 campaign to remove yourself from the business and get on with doing some of that stuff that you want to do, some of those passion projects that previous listener questions have touched on, and I know you all have. And it'll also allow you to just do other things in your business that you've been putting off, that you know if you do them, you'll get closer to building that empire. Next episode will be from Italy, somewhere in Italy. Could be a coffee shop sipping on an espresso. That was the worst Italian accent, Timbo. That was hopeless. That was kind of a mix of, I don't know. Don't know what that was. Might be from a gelato shop. Could be from Pompeii. That'd be kind of cool doing it from kind of a spa in Pompeii. Wherever it'll be, what it will be a reflection on the 12 months that has been for us small business owners. Some of the things that have raised my eyebrows, some of the interviews that have just made me go, wow, how good is that? The feedback from listeners, the things we could be doing better, that I could be doing better, that I didn't enjoy, that did enjoy. I don't know. It's just going to be, you know, a from the heart episode. So look out for that one. And upcoming guests too, hey? Gee, we've got some good ones. I've got an expert retailer, and I am talking expert retailer. I have got the world's number one drum teacher, insert drum sound effect. I have got a council worker who created a TV show promoting his own suburb, and so many more wonderful guests coming up. If you've got someone that you think would be good to come on the show and have a bit of a chin wag, a bit of a fireside chat with me, head over to smallbusinessbigmarketing.com and click on the contact me button, and there is an opportunity there to email me with an interview suggestion. I love them. Love a warm intro too. If you know that person, then feel free to introduce me over the airwaves, tim@smallbusinessbigmarketing.com. Hey, that's it. It's been another ripper show. I've loved bringing it to you. I hope there was some marketing gold there just dripping through your headphones. They wanna get my gold on the ceiling. Until next time, may your marketing be the best marketing.
You've been listening to the Small Business Big Marketing Show with Tim Reid. Want more marketing goodness? Then visit smallbusinessbigmarketing.com.